space and beautiful color plays to it. Not by any means the decision of a painting looker. A painting looker would have chosen the painting we're about to see next, a hand scroll that, for me, is far more interesting. But this painting, attributed to Zhao Baojiu, gets only a couple plates in this publication, long sections of it, they don't really show much. And generally, this painting, Zhao Baojiu painting, has not been published anywhere that I know of in plates that really show how fine a painting it really is. Okay, now we're going to spend more time looking at that. Zhao Baojiu, who died around 1162, let me talk about the painting a little bit before I come to him. The painting carries a colophon, an inscription mounted after the painting itself, written by some early Ming mounters. And according to this inscription, a group of early Ming painting mounters discovered this painting and presented it to the emperor. They recognized it, that is, as a major work, an important work by this famous artist, Zhao Baojiu. It isn't actually signed, but it's a fairly convincing attribution. This is a scroll titled Autumn Colors Over Rivers and Mountains, and is a long hand scroll. As I say, for picture lookers, as opposed to book readers, it's a far more interesting work, and I'm going to spend more time on it. Here we go. We knew the painting briefly or distantly from black and white reproductions that were published in Suren's book. Here's a general long section of it, not at all photographed by me. I couldn't make sections like this. I had to photograph it in a hand scroll case behind glass using my flash, and of course nothing like this is possible. This is from some reproduction. Well, as you see, the painting, it looks odd and maybe not all that great from the reproductions like this. And as I say, we saw it in something like this in Suren's book. And in other words, a bunch of wiggly-looking mountains or hills rising up, cliffs and so forth, twisting from a far middle ground, and then various things going on down below, buildings and figures and so on, and two water courses, river streams, whatever, coming out of the middle ground and flowing into the foreground to divide this extended foreground. Now that, of course, should remind you of the Emperor Ming's Long Journey to Shu, the painting copied after an early Tang work, which I talked about at length, and I talked about Tang landscape. Here it is. Now, when you look at it, you see that essentially it's the same thing. That is to say, twisting and strange peaks rising up in a kind of far middle ground, and then a foreground with figures and other things, horses and mules and so forth, divided by two streams that flow into the foreground, which way they're flowing is beside the point, but which divide the middle ground. So there's something really, something the artist took from paintings like this, maybe this very painting, to make his picture archaistic. Now here are sections of the Zhao Baojiu attributed picture, again taken by someone else. As you see, a number of buildings and figures and trees in the foreground, and then up and among the hills, various buildings and clusters of buildings. So it begins to look more interesting, but it's still nothing much there until you begin looking at details. Okay, now here is a reproduction again, a slide from a reproduction. The color is all wrong. Of the beginning of the scroll, and at least it shows us what the beginning of the scroll looks like, even though it's not a very good slide. It presents a broad river valley flowing out of the distance into the foreground, and again, figures and under trees and so on in the foreground, and then along the banks, clusters of buildings, villages, whatever, built along the shores, and on the left, these twisting continuous ridges and mountains begin, overhanging over the houses below, looking rather dramatic and so on. Now, when we come in, next please, here's a detail of the houses on the shore. It's obviously more interesting than the Wangxi Meng Scroll in the sense that it really, the shoreline recedes convincingly, and the trees are convincingly diminished as you go into distance. And there are geese on the shore here, you see, and the houses and so on. And then we go in closer here, next slide, and next image, I mean. And here is the cluster of buildings. And you see things are really happening. People are inside and outside the fence, and people are communing and so forth. And the buildings are drawn by somebody who's interested in how they are done. All right, now we will go on. What I can show you will be mainly details, and I won't even try to locate them in the whole composition. I can't do that. I don't have good slides of the whole composition. Here's another side of one of the sections, which at least shows us what the whole scroll looks like. That is, it's on fairly dark silk with fairly heavy blue and green color, which, however, instead of solidly covering the form, simply is applied to set parts of them on forms that are otherwise quite volumetric, treated with up-to-date ways of indicating volume and upper and lower sides and so on. I couldn't do this, even this slide, without getting bad reflection down at the bottom. As I say, it's really impossible to photograph a painting on a hand scroll painting in a case. But let's go on and look at details, and we'll see gradually what makes this scroll interesting. Here is a section of the a detail of the from the lower part of the scroll early on, and we see a man with a broad hat riding a donkey through the landscape under the pine trees. Beyond are mists floating through the trees, and a few flowering trees in the foreground. This season seems to be early spring. Well, there's actually snow on the trees in some places. And up above him, steps going up to a walled compound, a house. Okay, the next. Here we come in closer. Okay, the artist uses the colors quite skillfully to model the forms and to give space and to render the mists. The mists floating through the trees are quite beautifully rendered and so forth. Okay, now another section, another foreground. Here, a group of figures, a group of them making their way through the landscape, across a bridge, a kind of covered wagon, ox carts, donkeys again, and figures, and flowering trees and other trees beyond. And then you begin to see up above the people making their way up into the upper part of this painting. Here again, next please. Here are the figures, two men, high-class men, merchants, who knows, whatever, making their way with their servant, who's carrying the luggage as usual in front of them. The two of them are turning toward each other, and in winter landscapes, in cold landscapes, this is often true. You see two travelers, and they look toward each other as though they're kind of almost huddling together, figuratively. We see this in a painting we'll see later by Liang Kai, a marvelous winter landscape by him. Similarly, okay, then next please. Or here's a detail in which one of these mule trains has paused to rest, and the mules are being allowed to graze and to lie down by their grooms. And meanwhile, the other people are sleeping or resting under the pine trees. In other words, interesting narrative details and a lot going on in the picture. Okay, here is one of the longer sections which shows one of these two water courses, streams, whatever you'd call them, flowing out of the middle ground into the foreground. And where it originates, as you see, is a hollow, a kind of overhanging cave-like hollow, with a waterfall falling into it. And all around it, these twisting bluffs and hills and villas off on the left and so forth. Now, as you move in closer, the next, please. Here we go. This is a vertical slide that shows what's happening in the foreground. So in other words, you're moving back from a foreground that has trees and travelers and bridges and so forth into things going on in the middle ground, and then up from that, up into the upper part, where still quite a lot is going on, as we'll see. Now moving in still further, when you get really into this cave-like space and where the waterfall is, you see it's really, really quite interesting. A group of people here are standing on the shore, three men with their servant, one of the men pointing at the waterfall for a reason I never understood. When you have people gazing at a waterfall, one of them is usually pointing at the waterfall as if saying, look, there's the waterfall. I don't know what the reason for that is, but it's a Chinese convention anyway, and we find it over and over. And if you look a little to the right of these men, barely visible because the pigment has come off, you see the figure of another man seated on the shore, dangling his feet in the water. And then the quite beautiful waterfall itself and the pine tree, done with heavy green color, and other bare trees with a little bit of snow up to the left. Anyway, a really interesting scene, as we have throughout this painting. You can see here, by the way, for the first time, I think, that the artist has used strokes of gold along the contours of some of the landscape forms to give a kind of sheen or light or whatever, like sunlight striking them. Okay, going on. Here's another large section. As I say, I'm going through and showing details of this painting to show just what the quality of it is, what makes it interesting, without being able to fit them all into some large scheme. Somebody else will have to do that sometime when the painting is really properly published, as it hasn't been. Okay, here, figures making their way toward a cluster of houses in the foreground through bamboo. And then up above that, several people making their way up, starting to walk up the stairs toward a compound seen in the upper left. And then in the upper right here, we see a traveler with a broad hat and his servant pausing on the path, making his way up toward some other settlement, whatever, to look into a ravine, maybe another waterfall there. So things are going on all over, and one moves in imagination through the painting and climbs and penetrates the spaces and so on to see these figures. All right, next, please. Further up, this is the place where a man and his servant have walked through a gateway or the fence and are about to climb the steps on their way up to this compound. And you see it with the courtyard and somebody standing inside. And you see it with galleries, whatever you would call them, open rooms facing out so that people can eat or drink there and gaze out over the scenery. Well, there's something like this at the end of the Great Xiaogui Scroll that we'll see much later in Lecture 11. It's probably some kind of inn in the mountains where people can stop. Okay, next, please. And here is the section where you see the traveler on a mule with his broad hat, pausing to look into a ravine and pointing as though he's seeing something there. We don't know what. All bits of mystery and bits of drama and so on all through the painting. Now, here's a slide, next please, which I show just to show how the landscape forms are rendered in this remarkable work. Here down at the bottom is a place where the action of water flowing out of the distance, presumably, has eroded the rocks and in strange shapes, pitted, penetrated even. There's a place in the on the shore of the Taihu, the Great Lake in Jiangsu Province, where rocks of this kind are so interesting that they are cut out and transported to gardens and set up as a kind of sculpture, so-called Taihu Shi. Well, this is that kind of rock, but eroded by water. And you see here also the use of this rather spare use of green and blue color to not covering the whole forms, not flat, as in the Emperor Ming Huang and so on, but used on forms that are otherwise rendered quite convincingly and volumetrically up to date. The next, please. Yeah, here is a mountain, just to show these mountain ridges and how powerfully and dramatically they are